Hello, ladies and gentlemen. This is Dick Fehrman on the iPharma 2020 Goes Digital platform. I'm sitting here with Otto Kruse from Delft University. He's a theologian by education, and now he is, well, we could call him a sociologist in a very original way. And we're going to talk about political order, development, and the development of agriculture in Africa. You've written a book with two colleagues, and I was puzzled by chapter 7. You're introducing the notion of tribal entrepreneurship. Actually, Africans look down on agriculture because it is, in fact, subsistence farming. It's something for poor people who didn't succeed otherwise, and they still have to do agriculture to survive. And the men don't do it, it's women who do it. That needs to be changed, especially because of COVID-19. Africa doesn't have food sovereignty. It needs to build up its agriculture. And then you come in with this notion of tribal entrepreneurship to get agriculture going, to develop agriculture. Could you explain why you're using the notion of tribe there in that notion? The entrepreneur is a new tribe.
Yes, I called it the entrepreneurial tribe, because it is maybe not that much a traditional tribe, but the new tribe, the group, is created by this common mission. And you see that in many small enterprises, also in Western countries. The young people, they follow a leader, and he seems to be having the initiative, or she. But this group really goes for it, and they are, as it were, on an innovative track towards the future, and they want to realize something that isn't there. So we need that, but Africa needs it in a different way. But to that purpose, I would like a bit to explain how the tribes in Africa went about agriculture in the past, if you allow me. Usually, of course, you had tribes and empires in Africa, as everywhere in the world. But if you had an empire and an emperor above it, like in Ghana or in Zimbabwe, you would have also taxes. And in the vast emptiness of Africa, if you would be dissatisfied by the cruelty or the oppression or by the high taxes, as a tribe or as a group of people, you would just go away and start somewhere else. And that is the tradition of extensive agriculture. Extensive in the sense of low cost. You don't invest because that is too risky, but you try to survive with little means outside the imperial structure. And of course, that was no different during colonialism, because of course the British and the French, they all tried to get the farmers into the system by imposing taxes, because they thought now if they have to pay money, they also have to earn money, so they will go into the agricultural business. The Africans, moreover, many times tried not to do that because they stick to their old tradition, get out. And traditionally they could do so, but now they cannot anymore, because there is no out anymore in Africa. Everything is occupied everywhere you have borders, presidents, armies, control. So you are stuck now. So you have to cope with a new, different way of dealing with agriculture. On top of that, the tribes originally did not trust each other. It was never a big problem, because they were in contact via their leaders mostly, and they lived separately. But now they are mixed. And that is a new situation. So every African nation is so much involved in overcoming this traditional we group conscience that they even do not like the word tribe anymore. They use ethnicity rather, but they feel insulted often if you use the word tribe, although it is the same word in Greek or in Latin. So you need a tribal team, as it were, so that people from a different background work towards a common goal. Now, if you would go back historically towards the emergence of the tribe and the real history of the tribes, then you would always see that these tribes regrouped in manifold ways, or they broke away from the existing tribes, started something new. That was always as a response to a new imperative and challenge. We don't take this anymore, we go somewhere else, we try to be different. And then you would, in course of time, speak the same language. It would be another language, and you would be another tribe with another mission. So now we need that sort of mission again in Africa. But the thing is, we need it as well in the West, because Africa has too many we groups, which do not trust each other. And in the West, we don't have any group at all anymore. We have fragmented individuals in big machine-like societies, and they are all in search of their identity. And that needs to be channeled towards this mission of creating something new in an entrepreneurial way which serves society and adds value, also in agriculture. And there the West and Africa can meet. And I wanted to make that point in my book as well.
So the West is lost in individualism. There aren't any we groups anymore. And the Africans have to merge their we groups. Can that be done? I'm still puzzled. Tribes, from my very simple and basic view, are family structures. So you don't trust the one who is outside. And yet you just said they do accept people from the outside once they can set a common new goal. Could you elaborate on that?
It is not just a process that should start. It is already a process that is well underway. In my book, I call that the difference between System 1, traditional society, and System 2. System 1, tribes are separated, and maybe there is an empire above it, but everything is dependent on vertical networks of important people at the top and dependents at the bottom. And these networks often do not trust each other. So clans within the tribe repeat that structure. Repeat it because it's also the structure between the different tribes, traditionally speaking. But that doesn't exist anymore. There is also in Africa a system too. I call it system too because it is not just Western, but it is maybe of Western origin, but we don't realize it ourselves perfectly in the West. System two means you need more cooperation. We call that civil society and anonymous trust. We don't know the people, but we still deal with them. And we can do also because there is a state above us that keeps us in check in a certain sense in terms of transactions, contract enforcement, transparency. So the state should create an equal level playing field to make possible more cooperation at the bottom of society. Now, that is somewhere, each and every country in Africa is somewhere in between. And people live in two systems, as it were. Lifelong solidarity within the family and civil society under the umbrella of a universalist state. And a nice example, which every African will recognize who lives in a city, if there would be a harambee or a collection for a funeral, in the past, you would call upon your family members or the the village inhabitants. But now so many people all over Africa have one foot in their village, but they live in big cities. So if a family member dies, they do not only call upon their close family members anymore, but they also call upon their colleagues at a business or a university. Can you help me out? So that is a process, an example of a process that is developing, but sometimes all of a sudden system one features also pop up because you need to give a job to a friend, you need to spend some money to an important person to get a license, etc. That's all system one. But every African wants to go to more system two. And one more reason that I call it system two, we cannot just say that in the West we have system two. We might be willing to say that. And yes, we have more system two, but we also have the old boys network, which is actually a sort of a tribe. And now we have many national identities. We tend not to trust each other as nations, or within nations, some people try to create vertical networks once more. So we are, in a way, retribalizing. Our politicians, our right-wing politicians, call upon our tribal sensory of trying to belong to something bigger, which also includes you and gives you an identity. But my point is, we shouldn't have that at a political level. We should have that in a shared enterprise. We should do that by working together. And it can also be community entrepreneurship. You see the beautiful examples of that also in Europe. But you might call that tribal. And then there Africa and Europe would meet and can reinforce each other for a better future.
So Otto, you're telling us there is trust. There is tribal trust within the clan. You trust one another, because if you cheat, you will be kicked out of your clan. Mm-hmm. Modern trust, anonymous trust, is based on structures, is based on state, is based on if we don't trust one another anonymously, the whole system will collapse and we want to advance the system.
I would like to make the point that it is not completely due to the system we have. You also have to maintain it. And I'm worried because we are losing on it. You have to exercise trust in order to maintain trust.
Please explain, why are we losing trust?
If big companies enter our economies and they do not have to pay taxes because they get a privileged treatment, then the common man thinks who has to pay his taxes, this is no good. If cheating becomes normal, and we have quite a big drugs mafia also in this country, then you start checking whether they will also deliver, you know. The internet is a marvelous thing, we can order what we want, but nowadays you need to check, are they still reliable? So this reliability needs to be exercised. Of course, also controlled, but it is also an inner value that you need to maintain together. And if you lose it, it's difficult to gain it back.
So in Western societies, these big companies and the trust issue, does that company exist? They offer something on the internet, but do they really exist? They suck the system. They destroy it.
They do.
And they bring it. And they're bringing this development back to a tribal level. Then you need to reconnect, set a new goal, and start out from there. And that is where new tribes can create new futures.
Thank you. Yes.
And Otto, how do we recreate or create agriculture from this approach? How to create this entrepreneurial tribe in agriculture?
Now, I'm working within the Delft Center for Entrepreneurship in a program, International Entrepreneurship for Development. 60 students each year, we can't do that less this year, in groups of three, do an internship of 3 months for a company in Africa, India, Suriname, anywhere in the world. So young people, that's already... Well, three is a very small tribe, but it is still, we go and we have our adventure and we have our responsibility all in one. And we try to contribute in a meaningful way. People grow from that. Societies also grow from that. In that sort of approach, knowledge is also inserted. So students of us devise business plans, help farmers to get used to a computer for bookkeeping and keeping track of the produce, try to find a market and learn their counterparts to be oriented on the market and not only on old farmers' traditions. So this exchange should be much broader. And what we suffer from is that we try to start with the money and then we lose the spirit because our horticultural entrepreneurs in the Westland, they all want to do good things for Africa. That is not a discussion. But it should give for these companies an immediate revenue, otherwise they will not survive, they feel. And to an extent, it is true. You cannot transfer the technology like just also like that. That also needs time and learning and capacity training. But you could devise, they can be involved in a long-term program of knowledge transfers, building first on volunteers and, yes, charity and commitment. And from there, something can be built and grow. And that takes time. And the time horizon should be bigger. And, well, what we do with 60 students, we should do that with hundreds.
Do you think the Africans will trust these students?
Most of our students have a marvelous time because the Africans are very friendly people. They make connections. They like the presence of the students. And the presence of young people who want to show what they can is always very beautiful to see and to experience, also for the African counterparts. But on the longer term, what you want is that new forms of cooperation start, that our students learn a bit of a different life rhythm, because taking time is a good thing. We should do it more. And the African can also learn to get used to productive time rhythms and the multitasking that is almost coming amongst our students, but not so much among African, surely not among African peasants.
Otto, thank you very much for this interview.
Thank you as well for the opportunity.